much, Jack and Shelley. Appreciate it. We took up a few minutes with the introduction, so I'm going to speak faster to make sure that we cover all the material. I just want to say a couple of words of thanks myself, and then we'll get straight to the material. First of all, I want to say thank you so much to the Kehillah for expressing so much enthusiasm for these classes. You know, academics, we just need someone to talk to. If no one will listen to us, we feel useless. So it's so wonderful that all of you come out here and help me along with my personal therapy when we talk about history and things like that. I certainly can't do it at home, so at least I can come here and do these things. When we edit this, we'll just remove that little thing about home, I think. Okay. At any rate, special thanks tonight to several people. First of all, I want to thank Joe and Zohara Weiss, who I think were the strongest supporters of this class. Please come on. They really set the tone for what should happen here, and I think you've noticed a few improvements. First of all, at the end of tonight's lecture, no one will have to turn the chairs around for davening tomorrow. And second of all, we have my lovely daughter Aliza, who's greeting you at the front to give out materials and so on. And we have Mr. Rodriguez, one of our students at Touro College South, who is going to be videotaping it. And in case I didn't make it clear to you earlier, we're going to be putting these lectures entirely on the web as a service to the Jewish people. Just available for free, no charge, just like they are here. And we think this will be something that will enrich the Jewish people in a small way, but I think it's the right thing to do. Also, I want to thank my friend Stephen Mills, AKA Meatloaf, who has been a great supporter of the technical aspects of this project, and he's helped with a lot of the search engine optimization that we've done. Last thing, we do have a donation page that will help offset the cost. The shul has been very generous purchasing the camera and the projector and the screen and things like that so we can make these lectures possible. We'd like to give that money back to the shul. So when you visit the website, which is very hard to remember, it's www.jewishhistorylectures.org. And if you click on .com, it will still work because I bought both domains. Then you'll be taken to a link where you can donate directly to the shul, and it'll be earmarked for the costs of this class and for its expansion. I think that's great. We have two sponsors for this week's lecture. The lectures happen whether we get sponsorships or not, but obviously we'd like to get more of them. Mr. and Mrs. Menachem Sternbaum and Susan Leventon and an anonymous donor have underwritten the costs of this week's lecture. We figured out for this semester it would cost approximately $265 to pay for everything we've bought per lecture. So we're asking for $200 to sponsor the lecture. Whatever you want to give, if you want to give, is wonderful, and we're very appreciative. Okay, I think that's it for the general introductions. I think I've met almost all of you, but for those of you who don't know me, my background is I'm a historian. I received my PhD from the University of Toronto in 1995, and it coincided with my sort of discovery of Judaism together with my wife. And so I mixed my graduate career and my postgraduate career bouncing around between the Hebrew University and Or Sameach and the Oxford University and the Chai Society and Harvard and a few other really great schools, Cornell. And so I've had really a wonderful experience in some of the top universities of the world, Baruch Hashem, and I've also had the experience of learning Torah full-time. And both these things really come together in my teaching, I think, and I really try to strive for the high rigor of academia that I've experienced in the Ivy League, and at the same time the varmkeit and the bren of Torah that I received in yeshiva, and I'm hoping I can communicate some of that to you tonight. The class is going to be essentially a survey of modern Jewish history, like a first year undergraduate survey. It is pitched to a little bit higher level because so many of the people in this audience are very well educated and are very well read. But it's still generic enough that if you have no idea what the topic is on, you should come away with some useful information. The approach is going to be biographical, just like last semester. Well, I will use people, sometimes famous, as today, sometimes not so famous, to illustrate the general trends of Jewish history and the forces that shape the Jewish world. Since I am primarily specialized in modern Eastern Europe, anytime I step, let's say, anywhere west of Poland, and anytime before, let's say, 1648, I'd like you to please not ask any hard questions, because it's not my real area of expertise, but that's basically it. Okay, so are we ready for a quick joke, and then we'll talk about Rabbi Yosef Karo? Okay, so Rabbi Yosef Karo, he's known as the Mechaber in the yeshiva world, the author, meaning he is the ultimate composer of a book for the generations. And that book, of course, is none other than the Shulhan Arukh, the set table, which is the code of Jewish law that has become universally accepted in the Jewish world as the sine qua non statement of Jewish normative behavior. In that context, I'd like to tell you a joke about somewhat antinomian behavior. And it's a joke that involves a fictional rabbi that has no relationship to this shul at all, of course. But the joke goes like this. This rabbi, you know, for years and years, he's been devotedly serving his congregation. But all his life, he's been tortured by the question in his mind of what does pork really taste like? And he has, like, on Yom Kippur in particular, he has this terrible temptation. He just can't get rid of it. He decides he has to exorcise this terrible demon from himself, and he's going to follow the advice of the Gemara, dress in dark clothes, and go to a faraway neighborhood where he will, you know, exorcise his will and hopefully not have this demon torture him anymore. He goes way out into, like, Weston or someplace like that, and he finds a Chinese restaurant. He goes into the very back in the dark place, and he's wearing, you know, a baseball cap. I don't know if you've been walking around the beach lately, but at this time of year, there are all these people who come straight from Brooklyn with, you know, the full black coffin, things like that, but they're wearing a baseball cap. So it's like they're in disguise. Nobody knows. You would never. So anyways, he goes, he's sitting in the back, he's wearing a baseball cap, and he says to the waitress the story. He doesn't say about the rabbi part. He says, you know, I want you to give me your best pork dish. She says, okay, no problem. She walks away. He's sitting there. He's feeling so good about himself. And, of course, in walks the presidium and the board members for a late dinner. Of course, not associated with this shul or anything in this neighborhood. But the presidium walk in, and they see the rabbi in the back of the room. He's trying to hide under his hat. And they walk up to him and they say, Rabbi, what are you doing here? And just as they're talking to him, the waitress comes with the best pork dish on the menu. And of course, you guessed it, it's a suckling pig. You know, a huge pig. Can you, like, move the camera over here when people are talking about it? Like, thank you. And, like, people will think everyone's like, anyway, it's a big suckling pig. And everyone's speechless. And the rabbi finally says, can you believe this restaurant? You order a piece of fresh fruit, and look how they pachki it up. Okay, the start of the joke was better than the end. But let's go straight to the material. His dates are 1488 to 1575. Rabbi Yosef Karo, sometimes spelled with a C. It's the same person, obviously. He was born in Spain, possibly in Portugal, and he certainly suffered the deleterious effects of the Spanish and the Portuguese expulsion, which we discussed last semester in great detail. He was most famous as a halachist, but he has tremendous credentials as a Kabbalist as well. And I'm hoping towards the end of this lecture to try to describe how these two factors came together to create the unique personality that's found in the Shulchan Aruch itself. And as I mentioned, his claim to fame, his main claim to fame, is that he is the author of this code of Jewish law. His early years took him from Spain. His family fled from Spain into Portugal, where they were allowed to remain for several years, and then they were expelled once again. He went to Turkey, and he began a rather peripatetic existence, where he went from place to place. His primary teacher was his father, and later his uncle. So it was really very much a family affair, the way that he studied Torah. He was married three times, and he had seven known children, three unfortunately predeceased him. Here's an interesting Israeli, this is a Yishuv era postage stamp. We have no idea if this picture, which is the iconic image of the Mechaber, is actually looks like him, but that's sort of like the picture of the Rambam that you see over and over again. It's sort of like everyone's agreed that must be what he looked at. He had quite close associations with many other rabbis of the period, and in fact, one of his daughters married the son of the famous Arizal, Rabbi Isaac Luria of Tzfat, and we'll speak about their association in greater detail. He also had some interesting influences from Shlomo Molcho, who was a fascinating character, and perhaps we'll spend more time speaking about him in greater detail in a later class, perhaps two semesters from now. Shlomo Molcho was also of Spanish origin. He was a converso who, like Uriel da Costa, that we spoke about a few weeks ago, decided to return to Judaism. But whereas Uriel da Costa was never completely comfortable with his conversion and could not find an intellectual space within the Sephardic communities of Amsterdam and elsewhere, Shlomo Molcho kind of like flipped out. He went completely, flipped out is a term that they use for the young people, you know, when they go to seminary and they come back and they don't want to eat your food and things like that. So he really flipped out. He had messianic pretensions. He had difficulty associating with any Jewish community because they thought he was all just too radical. He circumcised himself when he was in his 20s because he couldn't find a mohel who would do it. That's fairly extreme behavior. He had various negative relations with the Jewish community because he insisted they should radicalize and they should take greater steps towards accelerating the pace of messianic clock. And ultimately, he got into trouble with the state, and he was burned at the stake in 1532. This is actually his highly stylized signature that gives you a sense of what must be going on in his head if that's how he puts his John Hancock down. Rabbi Karo, however, was really quite impressed with the purity of motivation and intention of Shlomo Molcho, and among the many positive things that he said about him was that after seeing his death, he prayed that he himself would come to a similar end. Rav Karo wished to die a martyr's death like Shlomo Molcho. He did not receive that privilege, and there's not much to say about that. Rabbi Karo's fame really extends from the period of time that he spent in Tzfat, where he moved when he was 48. He had already been working on his magnum opus, which I'm going to discuss in a moment, the Beit Yosef. So he carried with him a certain measure of fame when he came into this very unusual circle of rabbis that were involved in this particular northern Israel city. There were a few factors that brought together some, you know, highly unique rabbis, including the Arizal that I mentioned earlier, his student Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, the Ramak, and Yosef Karo, among others. And Yosef Taitzak, who was also the teacher of Shlomo Molcho, was there at the time. There was, perhaps I should say, one of the most significant elements was the Abramson rule of history at work once again. Thank you so much, Sahara gets it. Money. There was suddenly Jewish money in the region. The Rothschilds had specifically secured a parcel of land in northern Israel that would make it possible for Jews to settle there and to pursue their scholarship. Because, you know, im ein kemach ein Torah, if there is no flour, there is no Torah. Suddenly in Tzfat, there was a small, tiny area where Jewish scholars were especially valued and could pursue their studies. And he came into this region with a significant amount of authority based on his previous works, and his authority grew even greater. Yes, please.
The Rothschilds were putting money into the 1500s?
Yeah, we got money back then earlier. And if I'm wrong, you'll never know until I put this on the web and I cut this whole discussion out. But I'm pretty sure it was the Rothschilds. Maybe Montefiore? It's too early for Montefiore. Yeah, I think it is Rothschilds. Okay. Let's go on to the next question. Okay, now let's talk about the Beit Yosef. This is his the book that really, among Sephardim in particular, he's more known for the Beit Yosef than he is for the Shulchan Aruch. And among those who learn halacha deeply, gain a much deeper respect for the Beit Yosef than for the Shulchan Aruch, which is much more popularly known. The Beit Yosef is essentially an encyclopedic commentary on the most current code of the time, the Torah. And in the next few slides, I'll take you through the process of codification and why it was so significant to have a commentary like the Beit Yosef. But basically, one of the things that plagued the commentators in their creation of codes is that it was simply too onerous to explain all of their thought processes. So it was much easier for a codifier to simply say, this is the halacha, please don't bother me anymore. And in later generations, you know, when the author's personal status was no longer quite as well regarded, or if someone wrote a competing code, then no one could really sort out which code was appropriately followed. What the Beit Yosef did was it delved into the reasoning of the Tur, and that's from Asher, I'll show you him in just a second, and he brought all of the relevant passages from the Talmud to support the decision of the Tur. In other words, he completely explained, he dug in an archaeological fashion, and he discovered what was the reasoning of the Tur for arguing a particular position. He then went on to do the same thing, by the way, for Maimonides in a commentary called the Kesef Mishnah. And by writing this commentary, the Beit Yosef, he demonstrated that he had absolute control over the meaning of the text as written by the Torah. It was the ultimate critical analysis of a halachic code, and it was a phenomenal act of scholarship that undoubtedly provided him with tremendous appropriate regard. It took him 20 years to write it. It took him far less time to write the Shulchan Aruch itself, which is much more well known. And the main purpose was he provided the Talmudic background for the decisions of the Torah. Okay. Any questions about the Beit Yosef yet? Okay, so let's go to the actual process of codification. And I apologize, some of these slides were already presented in the Maimonides lecture. I hope you've totally forgotten them, so they won't look too familiar.